When I was sitting in front of the television and saw those results come in the early hours of the morning, as a passionate Remain campaigner, there was that sinking feeling as we moved toward, inexorably towards the result, a feeling that then replicated as the American presidential election results came in last year. But I travelled the country, I talked to a great number of people, and the reason why 52% of the population voted to leave was, for me, about a whole host of things. Yes, migration and immigration, and change, and loss, and stagnant wages, and austerity, and sovereignty, a desire not to be told what to do anymore by others. But I would sum it up as a feeling we don't think that you are listening to us. And if someone was standing on this stage today representing the 52%, they would look everyone in the audience who voted Remain and say, you're listening now, aren't you? And I say that because there were constituents of mine who would never vote in a general election, who came out and voted on that day because they felt it was an opportunity to use political power to bring about change. And I say that because we need to understand why 52% of the population voted as it did. The 48% feel a sense of loss now, and they are mourning for what has happened. And all of us who voted Remain know exactly what that feels like. But there was first of all a fundamental choice. Do you accept the outcome of the referendum or not? Now, my view is you have to accept the outcome of the referendum. I know there are those who don't. I know there are those who urge parliamentarians to vote against the Article 50 legislation. I voted for it because I thought it was a democratic necessity. And if Parliament had voted against the Article 50 legislation, it would in effect have said to the British people, those who voted, I'm afraid we know better than you. Go away and we're going to decide what's going to happen. And if you think we have a crisis of confidence in our politics in Britain, in France, in Germany, in the United States of America and many other countries around the world at the moment, it would be as nothing to the crisis of confidence we would have had if that had occurred in our politics here in the United Kingdom. But, and it's a very important but, the referendum decided one thing, the fact that we are leaving the European Union. It did not decide the terms on which we leave. It did not decide the nature of the new relationship we're going to have with our friends and neighbours, who will still be our friends and neighbours even when the process of withdrawal has been completed. And I think it is very important, I'm speaking personally here, because the committee's views are those expressed in the two reports we've published so far and the third report, which is coming out tomorrow. But I'm speaking for myself today. We need, those who are concerned to get the right outcome from this process, need to come together to ensure that that is the case. And I wanted to make that point very strongly here today. Now, this is the most complex, most challenging negotiation the country is engaged in. Well, it's the biggest peacetime challenge we've had since the end of the Second World War, bar none. And I was on Any Questions on Friday night and said, the last 9 months has been a bit like we've been sitting discussing what we'd like to order off the menu in a restaurant. Well, I think we'll have a free trade deal and we'll have access for our services and we'll have continued cooperation here and there, as we should. And look, I want the best deal for Britain. Every single one of us wants the best deal for Britain. But as the negotiations begin, as the Article 50 letter was delivered and the response was published, it's like we've now entered the restaurant to discover that not all of the things that we were anticipating are necessarily on the menu. And the owner has come up and said, right, the first thing we've got to do is to talk about how much you're going to pay for your meal before we get to discover what it is we are able to eat. Now, that is an analysis of the position that we are in. And the truth is that in the end, what comes out of these negotiations will depend on what the 27 member states are prepared to consent to, as well as on the arguments that we make in favour of a good deal for Britain, that, in my view, in the end, would be a good deal for the European Union, given the circumstances in which we find ourselves. Now, there are many, many elements to this, and one of the things I have learned just about every single day since I took on the task of chairing the Brexit Select Committee is the more you look, the more you learn about issues and questions that people have, which run very simply like this: what's going to happen the day after we leave to this, to that? When we met the tech sector recently, we asked, as we do, okay, what's your number one ask in the negotiations? And they said it's very, very important that the Commission issues a data adequacy decision in respect of the United Kingdom. Now, I must confess to you, before I heard those words, I had no idea what a data adequacy decision was. But as it was explained to us, it is the Commission saying of the United Kingdom as a third country, because the 1 minute past midnight, we become a third country. The Commission saying, yes, the way in which data is handled in the United Kingdom is adequate, and therefore it can move back and forth. Who does that matter to? It matters to a very large number of data centres in the United Kingdom. We've been very successful in establishing data centres. It matters to a lot of companies that handle the data of European citizens in going about their daily work here in the United Kingdom. And that's just one example, never mind financial services. Over a million jobs, most of them not in the City of London. A lot of them are in Leeds and Edinburgh and Glasgow and other parts of the country. It's a great strength. Economically, it pays a great deal of tax, and therefore making sure that we preserve our tax base is an important objective in these negotiations. What is going to replace passporting if passporting doesn't continue? Will it be some mutual recognition arrangement? What will happen to the Open Skies Agreement within Europe, and also the EU-US Open Skies Agreement, because in the absence of any new deal, the United Kingdom falls out? What will happen to emergency medical insurance treatment when we travel to Europe using our EHIC cards, which I'm sure many of us have got with us here today? What about recognition of professional qualifications? What about the possibility of the return of tariffs and non-tariff barriers to trade? Because we've taken a great deal of evidence in the Select Committee, and almost every person from business who's come to appear before us has said, look, top of our list is please no return to tariffs and non-tariff barriers to trade. Now, if you're a dairy farmer or a beef farmer, the prospect of tariffs of 30 to 40% is a pretty worrying thought. The tariffs overall on average, what, around 3.5%, but it's the non-tariff barriers that are very important to many businesses, because over 44 years, our economies, our way of working, have become intertwined, and we are now involved in doing this and then trying to re-establish some of the connections. But some people aren't entirely sure what that is going to mean. And if you think of supply chains that have been established on the basis that it is as easy to move goods from Paris to Berlin to London as it is from London to Leeds to Manchester, non-tariff barriers are very, very important indeed. People. The other thing that business has said to us has been, we rely on the movement of labour and skills, whether you are the NHS and its need for nurses, the care sector. One in five of our care workers looking after our grandparents, our mums and dads, and one day it'll be our turn, because this is a universal experience, getting old, already come from outside the United Kingdom. To people picking and processing vegetables in East Anglia, or delivering lectures at universities, colleagues of Catherine's. Now, how are we going to manage that? Free movement will come to an end when we leave. We're going to have to agree as a nation a new immigration system for European Union citizens. And we need to debate how that is going to operate, so that the government's declared intention, which I welcome, saying to businesses, don't worry, we're not going to leave you in the lurch when it comes to skill needs. How is that going to work in practice? What will be the process that is involved? But it does run up against another bit of government policy, which is the net migration target, which should not have university students in it at all. But the two, it seems to me, are not possible to be reconciled if you're going to do those two things. And then there is the question of money and the time there is for negotiation. Clearly, very evident in Donald Tusk's letter was the question of payment, the bill. Now, there are different elements to that. There is the bill for outstanding liabilities. There are the share of the assets that we have. And then there is the question of payments for future access. Because the Prime Minister said in her speech at Lancaster House that the government was prepared to consider buying in to a number of programmes. Now, that might be Horizon 2020, which is so important for our universities and for scientific research. It might be the Erasmus programme that enables students to travel and study in other European countries. Very important for students from low-income backgrounds. That matters a lot to me and the constituency that I represent. And then the other part of the divorce arrangement, which is the new framework. And Article 50, as you know, says you have to take account of the new framework in reaching an Article 50 deal. By definition, therefore, you have to have a new framework in order to take account of it. But 18 months is not very long. 18 months is even less time if you take into account the French election, the German elections, the fact that the European Council won't meet until the 29th of April to finally decide what its negotiating instructions are to Michel Barnier and his team, who will negotiate with David Davis. And therefore, the fact that the EU wants to bring this to an end by October of 2018 to allow time for parliaments, including the British Parliament, including the European Parliament, including member states, to look at what they think of the deal, means we haven't got a great deal of time. And that is why the government's wish on trade to say, in effect, we wish to leave the customs union to negotiate free trade deals with the rest of the world, but to this extent we'd like to stay, because can we carry on with tariff and barrier free trade? It remains to be seen what response the European Union gives to that. It is possible they will say, this, I'm afraid, looks a bit too much like having your cake and eating it. We don't know yet what the outcome will be. And therefore, maybe that agreement will set out the wish to negotiate a comprehensive free trade and market access agreement. Because the tariffs, it's quite simple, we're zero tariffs now. I've met no one who says, yes, I'd like to go back to tariffs on either side. So that's relatively straightforward. But when it comes to services, what is going to happen to all of those sectors of the economy that have arrangements now that in the absence of a deal will cease to exist at a minute past midnight? How is that all going to work? And therefore, if you cannot negotiate what would be the most far-reaching and ambitious free trade and market access agreement really in international history in the space of 18 months, you're going to need one other thing, which is transitional arrangements. Absolutely essential. And in our first report as the Select Committee, we said to the government, you need to be clear about the importance of transitional arrangements. We also argued for the white paper, which was then eventually published. We also called for the government to give Parliament a vote on a draft deal. And that is some evidence of the Select Committee and others having influence on the approach that the government itself is taking. Just one other thing I want to touch on, which is the Great Repeal Bill, because while the negotiations go on, we had the publication of the Great Repeal Bill white paper last Thursday. Very sensibly, in my view, the government is saying that the acquis communautaire, European law, insofar as it is not already in UK domestic legislation, should be picked up, moved across, and put down, so the day after we leave, we have the same rules and regulations and laws as the day before. There will need to be some changes of necessity in what those regulations decisions say. If it says the Commission shall, well, you can't have that in UK law the day after. It can't have a reference to a European agency if we're no longer members. So the government will need to find a mechanism for making those changes and has proposed the use of delegated legislation. For me, I think the two most important things are, one, if those powers are given by Parliament through the bill, then they must only be used for the limited purpose of making sure the legislation still makes sense the day after. And secondly, speaking personally, I would wish to ward off those who are already making their voice heard last week, saying, well, while you're moving them across, I've never liked that regulation, and I think we should get rid of that. Because the proper place to have that debate will be in the future, and that will be hotly argued. I don't regard health and safety legislation as an example of European bureaucratic red tape. I don't regard the fact that the European Court of Justice was responsible for part-time workers in Britain winning the right to become members of pension schemes. I don't regard that as a bit of bureaucratic red tape. And I also welcome the fact that the government has made it clear in that white paper that all of the existing body of European case law will be taken account of in British legislation up to the point at which we leave. And that I do welcome, because it means that we're not going to lose that body of legal opinion. So the honest answer when people come and say, well, what do you think is going to happen, Hillary? And I'm sure we ask each other the same question is, I don't really know. And that's the truth. I suppose my pragmatic side says, in the end, there will be a deal that is going to work. One has to acknowledge that Europe is worried about the hole in its budget. We have to acknowledge that Europe worries about the unity of the European Union minus the UK. They worry about contagion, and therefore that's why they've said, well, Britain can't possibly have as good a deal outside as you had inside. In what respect will that deal be less in terms of what they're prepared to offer? And just as one could make the case that some people in Britain in the referendum voted against what others might regard as their economic self-interest because they attached a higher priority to something else, sovereignty, don't be entirely surprised if in the European Union the same argument materialises. But that depends on the judgment that they are going to make. What we have to do is to ensure that we continue to use our voice and our influence to support the process of getting the best possible outcome, and that is what the Select Committee that I have the honour and privilege to chair intends to do all the way down the line to the end of this. Thank you very much. Now, you make the contrast between the Commons and the Lords. The difference in the Commons is the Conservatives won the last general election. That's the kind of fundamental problem, despite our best endeavours as the Labour. Hang on, pardon? I know it's a slim majority. I'm there every day voting and losing, sometimes by a slim majority and sometimes by a larger majority. Believe you me, I know what it's like to be on the receiving end of defeat. Whereas in the House of Lords, and you'll know this, since the coalition government broke down, because before it was the Tories and the Lib Dems voting together, now the government in effect, depending on the views of the crossbenchers, don't have a majority in the House of Lords. Now, on the two Lords amendments to the Article 50 bill, which was one in relation to the rights of EU citizens that I didn't mention, and the Select Committee in its second report said to the government, you should make a unilateral decision now to guarantee the position of the EU nationals who are here, because the only circumstances in which you wouldn't do that is if, in some way, you were prepared to put their future in play in the negotiations. And I don't believe the government would do that for a second, because I take them at their word when they say we want everyone to stay. So you might as well do that now, because it then puts great moral pressure on the other member states, who I'm sure will say, yeah, the 1.2 million Brits can stay also, because we need to get this done, because it is creating a huge amount of uncertainty for those who are here, and especially those who are applying. And I pay tribute to Catherine for the evidence she gave to us at a very early meeting of the Select Committee that raised a lot of these questions in our mind as a committee. Those who are applying for permanent residence cards, 30% of applications currently are being turned down for lack of information or for other reasons. Well, that just adds to the feeling of uncertainty, even though actually you don't have to apply for a permanent residence card. So it's the parliamentary mathematics. I voted, as did Labour, for the government to give that commitment and try to attach it to the bill. I voted for there to be a meaningful vote, both in respect of a draft deal and no deal at all. Now, that's us doing our job as the Labour opposition, but we can't pretend, and I understand the frustration, but we can't pretend that the government doesn't have a majority in the Commons, which is why I made my point a little earlier. Those who are trying to influence the outcome in what we regard as a sensible and positive direction have got to come together, and if we have an argument amongst ourselves, that just makes the argument we're trying to make in respect of a reasonable type of Brexit as opposed to a bad Brexit much harder to advance. That's my argument. In campaigning for us to remain, I wasn't going up and down the country saying the European Union is perfect in every respect, cannot be improved upon, it's fabulous, because I have criticisms like other people have. I sat on the Council of Ministers as a British Cabinet Minister for 7 years, and I've seen the process working from the inside. And I would just say that for the EU, once this immediate negotiation is over, may want to pause and ask itself, now how was it that we lost one of our most significant and important member states? How come is it that no European country wants any treaty change that might require under their own legislation a referendum? Because every single one of those countries thinks, even if the referendum was to change the word A to the word the in a European treaty, is not entirely sure that they would win it. There's a message there. And my argument is that the two forces in politics right around the world are, one, the necessity for international cooperation to deal with the challenges, climate change, refugees, threats to peace and security, trade, and on the other hand, the desire for self-determination. And I think in part what the referendum showed was that 52% of people were saying, we don't think the balance is quite right. And it's right and proper that we should reflect upon that. But it is for Europe to make that decision, because we will be leaving. What we need is to have good analysis of the options, but also the consequences if those options come to pass. And as I've said to you today, I think no deal, which would result in us leaving with nothing, return of tariffs, non-tariff barriers to trade, the end of all of the arrangements that have given us access to, because of our membership of the single market, I think that would be a very, very bad outcome. And if you listen to Keir Starmer and his excellent team and MPs right across the House of Commons, you will hear those arguments being advanced with great force and great clarity. And we just have to continue the work and the pressure to get a decent and a reasonable outcome. Our first visit to a capital was to Dublin to talk to parliamentary representatives there. We will be going to Londonderry to see the position from the other side of the border. Everybody recognises the enormous importance of ensuring that what is the result of the referendum does not impact upon what is unbelievably important but still, in some respects, fragile peace process. Everybody recognises that a return to a hard border with border posts and things coming down and so on is an invitation to those who are unreconciled to the peace process to have a go. And therefore, we have to find a way of making this work. And I welcome that Michel Barnier, when he spoke last year, acknowledged the importance, as indeed have other European leaders, of finding a pragmatic way of dealing with that question. But when we were in Dublin, the reason I mentioned beef and dairy tariffs is there's a lot of trade that is, you know, the cows are milked on one side and the milk goes to the other side in order to be processed, and beef cattle come south to be slaughtered. So it happens all the time, and farmers worry a great deal about any prospect that there would be a return under the no deal outcome to tariffs, 30-40% tariffs. Never mind the impact that trade deals with other countries might have if they want access for their agricultural products to the UK as part of the deal. So we're very, very aware of that, and I haven't seen anybody who doesn't understand that. The trick is to ensure that the deal makes that happen. Well, if heaven forbid if there was a referendum on hanging, well, I would not vote for it because I regard it as a moral question. But I have to tell you, the decision about membership of the European Union was a political question. It was a political question. And we didn't in the referendum, because it was inevitable once the Tories had won the election, we didn't say, we're having a bit of trouble making up our minds about whether we should stay. Can you just give us a view? No, we clearly, as Parliament, passed the decision to the British people. We did. Now, I recognise and I understand there are those who say it was only advisory. Legally, that is true. Politically, it completely misses the point. It completely misses the point. And I tried to express the argument earlier, and I can see you shaking your head and you don't agree. But I worry about the state of our democracy. And a democracy in which Parliament turned round, in which there are a majority of Remainer MPs, that's true, and said, go away, we know better. You know who the only beneficiary of that would have been? It would be the populists. And you know what? We have enough of a trouble in many countries with the populists, who of course come along when times are difficult, and they say, are you having a hard time? Are you having a hard time? Believe me, I understand you're having a hard time. And you know why you're having a hard time? It's all the fault of those people over there. History is littered with examples of people who have tried to gain political power by doing that, and we have to stand against them. But it does mean listening. It does mean listening to what people say, even though we may profoundly disagree with the judgment that 52% of the population made. Now, that is my argument, and I respect those who take a different view, but there are consequences either way, and if we're honest with each other, we will recognise that there are consequences either way. In my view, we will, of course, need transitional arrangements. That is the committee's view. On free movement, I don't know whether there would be any agreement to finesse, given that we were on our way out. For the ECJ, I think that is more difficult. The government has decided to make continued authority of the ECJ a red line, I think principally because it is the direct applicability of their decisions, whereas in the case of our membership of the WTO, as a member state, we and everyone else is obliged to abide by the rulings of the dispute resolution body. But it doesn't have direct legal effect in our country. Incidentally, in the same way that rulings of the European Court of Human Rights, nothing to do with the European Union, their judgments don't have direct legal effect. If they did, then some prisoners would have the vote, because they ruled, what, 8 or 9 years ago, you can't bar all prisoners. So they declared that what we have at the moment in the UK is incompatible. Parliament then voted, well, actually, we're going to keep it the way it is. And the situation hasn't changed. So that is the, for me, that is the difference in the government's mind between the two things. I think the answer is it will depend on the judgment of how important the transitional arrangements are to avoid something that is really bad, against having to say to certain people, for a little bit longer, we will need to do this and this until we have negotiated our comprehensive free trade and market access arrangement. But that remains to be seen. There were a lot of things that were in people's minds in choosing to vote to leave the European Union, which are not directly related to our membership of the European Union. And the article that Ed Miliband and I wrote in The Observer yesterday was in large part about that, because we need to address those, in a sense, notwithstanding what is going on in the negotiations. People concerned about the inability of their children to afford to have somewhere to live, to buy, to rent. How do we stop a greater insecurity coming with further technological change? I've got four children. How are the next generation going to be able to save for a pension? How do we deal with the social care crisis? We have a crisis, and it's our turn next. Now, these are big, important political questions where part of understanding the message that was sent by people who voted in the way that it did. And by the way, a lot of those things are also of concern to Remain voters. This is not an exclusive Leave concern to talk about those things. Politics has a job to respond to that as well. We're going to have the Great Repeal Bill. We're then going to have subsequent legislation. We've already been told something on immigration by definition, because we've got to establish a new policy on customs, could be on financial services, environment, who knows. Then there are all of the statutory instruments. The white paper said there could be between 800 and 1,000. In each year, on average, over the last 10 years, there's been between 1,000 and 1,300 in Parliament per year. So that, in effect, in a short space of time, if you want all of those to be dealt with, by the time we leave, bearing in mind that the what we need to do may not be clear until we see how the negotiations are going, that concentrates a lot of those statutory instruments potentially into quite a short space of time. That is a big workload for Parliament. Look, it will be our job to find a way of dealing with it. I very much welcome the fact that so many select committees are undertaking work, because with the best will in the world, the Brexit Select Committee, fantastic though the clerk and his team are, and the quality and abilities of all of the members of the committee, we can't take evidence on everything, and therefore we rely greatly on the work that other select committees are doing. And I would say, I think Parliament in that respect is doing a very good job, because every day almost a report comes out which increases our knowledge base and helps us to understand what is really, really important. In the end, you can dress up how the itemised bill looks like really any way you like. So you might have a smaller element, which is the exit bill, and a larger element, which is the payment for future access. From Europe's point of view, their interest is in the sum total because of the hole in the budget they've got. And because they've got a hole in their budget, the net contributor nations in Europe think, well, crumbs, we're going to have to pay more. And the net recipient nations in Europe will think the net contributors won't pay any more, and therefore we're going to get less. So that is a political problem for the European Union. But I would presume that politics will come into play in determining how those different elements are presented. And look, I think this negotiation will come down to the trade-off between money and a trade deal and access. Because, in effect, Article 50 encourages that, because it says you've got to deal with the divorce, including the money, but you have to have regard, take account of the new framework. So those are the two elements of what I think and hope very much will be a final deal that is reasonable. Well, the government did acknowledge in the white paper that there would have to be a dispute settlement body of some sort. But ministers have also, I've heard them say, if we had a trade agreement with the United States of America, the dispute resolution body would not be the Supreme Court of the United States, would it? So I think the answer is a mutually acceptable arrangement will have to be found. Some people have argued, could you use the EFTA court as a model? But it would have to be agreed between the parties to a trade agreement. I don't think it could be any more than it could be the Supreme Court over the road here adjudicating on a deal that the UK has reached with the European Union after we've left. The ICJ, I'm not so sure about that, but I'm not a lawyer. There have been two phases to this. There has been the whole triggering of Article 50. Now, because Gina Miller brought her case and persuaded the High Court that rights given by Parliament could only be taken away by Parliament and not by the use of the royal prerogative, which is a very important constitutional judgment, slightly misunderstood by some people at the time that somehow we weren't leaving the European Union. It was, of course, a ruling about whose finger is on the button to dispatch the letter via Sir Tim Barrow to Donald Tusk, and that's what happened. I think during the course of that debate, it wasn't fantastically helpful, because it felt to me at times as if the referendum argument was being rerun again and again and again. Because any suggestion, going back to your question about the amendments that the Lords wanted to add to the Article 50 bill, which Labour voted for, others would say, you're just trying to undermine the decision of the referendum. This is completely unacceptable. Now, we have got that out of the way now, and we can concentrate on the policy choices and the decisions we make about what it is that we're going to seek, what in the end we are prepared to agree to as the negotiations play out, and obviously what the politics in Europe is going to produce in terms of Europe's consent to a reasonable agreement. And I hope in the course of that we have less of what went on during the Article 50 process, because if you point out issues that need to be addressed, there might be some people who then want to bang you on the head and say you are not being patriotic. I don't accept that accusation for one second. We, as parliamentarians, have a job to do. We are not going to be bystanders in this process. We are going to be participants. It's why we are elected. And I wanted to be very clear about that. But I think there is a risk, going back to Claire's question, about the amount of time that there is to focus on other things that we need urgently to do as a society. And the legislative programme is going to be extremely heavy. But that is an inevitable consequence of the decision the British people made in June last year. And Parliament has just got to get on with it. Let's take one example, air quality legislation. Now, currently, the Commission is responsible for writing letters to people like me when I was the Environment Secretary saying, I'm afraid you haven't yet met the requirements to get the level of soot down below a certain level and you're not on course to do it for nitrogen dioxide. Who's going to take on that function? So the government will have to decide, do we give it to the Environment Agency? I don't know. And then, of course, ultimately, there was the European Court. How is it going to operate in domestic legislation? And I think particularly in the field of the environment, but there are others, you're right, there will need to be a more substantial discussion about how the legislation is going to continue to be operated. There'll be no doubt an argument about the Habitats Directive, because some people will want to get rid of it because they've found it an obstacle to the building of sufficient houses. And we will no doubt come to that discussion at some point. So there is the minimum to start with, but alongside that, and that is what I think some of the subsequent legislation is going to have to address. So it's not as if the Great Repeal is that's it. And that's why the government acknowledges that there will need to be further bills that will come that will deal in detail with the policy choices that we will have to make as a country about how these things are going to be operated, given that the mechanisms that Europe has created and which we have worked with will no longer exist after the day after we leave. I hope very, very much that the government will say in the negotiations, we wish to remain part of the Erasmus programme and we wish to contribute in order to fund it, because it's a terrific programme and we shouldn't lose it, as is Horizon 2020. And the sooner that can be clarified in the interests of students and higher education and research and collaboration and all of those things, the better.